Good morning, guys. How are we doing today? Today is day two of the coffee shop. Yesterday went really well. I'm exhausted. It was a long day. I was up by 5 a.m. and I was down here until 6 p.m. And then took a quick little nap, actually, and came down here and did my closing duties. And here we are again at 5:30, back here getting the coffee going. And it's probably actually now 6:30. We've got a few customers come in. It's great to be officially on the go. And yesterday, the response to the Jazz was really, really strong. People really enjoyed the atmosphere and the feeling of it. It's luxurious. It's comfortable to us from film soundtracks, mostly for people who don't know jazz. Jazz is placed in film so frequently that it creates an urbanity. It creates a romantic setting. I mean, you can really backdrop almost anything with jazz, but people just are really enjoying the textures and the feel that jazz is bringing today. Today we're featuring 7,000 sequence prestige records. We're starting off with some Billy Taylor, who's kind of an underappreciated cat, if you ask me. He's a great orator, storyteller, teacher. He's one of the guys who did a lot of teaching and a lot of presenting jazz to the mainstream. He had television programs where he was kind of instructing people how to hear jazz, and then he'd sit at the piano and he could play anybody, any style, from boogie-woogie to bebop. He was just a very proficient, talented player. He didn't record at Blue Notes, doesn't have that prestige perhaps, but he does record at prestige and at a lot of labels, to be honest. He's quite a proficient, prolific recorder and an incredible player. Here he's playing with Earl May on the bass and Percy Bryce on the drums. A cool prestige number, 7,051. So they're in the middle of that first sequence. Cool cover art. This is contemporaneous with what was happening at Blue Note graphic-wise. And one of the better covers Prestige does at this time, if you ask me. I like that cover quite a lot. Priceless OJC. 7,000 series Prestige. OJC is really the way you want to go. They're affordable. They sound great. Most come from analog tape. It's a valuable, valuable tool to collect old Riversides and old Prestige, old contemporaries. But Prestige really is the one, I think, that they really embraced a lot of the Prestige canon. By no means did they do all of it, and there's a lot of Prestige titles that are very anonymous, and there's a link between how anonymous a Prestige title is and whether or not OJC reissued it. OJC really puts a lot of titles in the lexicon for the modern collector from the 80s forward, that the titles that they omitted and didn't reissue, a lot of those have slipped into a great deal of obscurity and have become quite anonymous. Again, Prestige is a great label. Bob Weinstock runs it. The Junkies loved it because he paid them out cash every day. They had no titleship to their music. They just got paid for recording, and then it was a done deal. Some of these sessions aren't as organized or as rehearsed as, say, a Blue Note or a Riverside with Orrin Keep News, but there's still a lot of honest playing, a lot of tension-driven playing by addicts. They recorded largely African Americans with, you know, there was a good mix of white guys in there as well, unlike Blue Note, where there was no white guys at all after Gil Melly. But great stuff from the New York scene. And the New York scene in the late 50s, mid-50s, is an incredible nexus of talent from around the country all coming together in New York and playing on each other's records, playing under different leadership at different labels. It's quite a crossbred time in the jazz canon where everyone's playing with everyone. Even the races are starting to intermingle lineup-wise in the studio, which you don't get a lot before this period. They were intermingling live and backstage and after shows, but to do it in the studio is another step. And it starts to happen. You know, obviously Goodman introduces Charlie Christian and Teddy Wilson and Lionel Hampton, but it was definitely a uniquer thing. Taylor's a great player. I got some fun stuff coming today on Prestige. Let me just show you what I'm going to pull out here. So if you lived nearby, We probably do some Miles Davis today, collector's items. Some Gene Ammons, wonderful tenor player. Some Monk with Rollins. And I think Frank Foster's on this as well. Who Foster's a great tenor player, played with Basie. Some Red Garland, who everyone knows I'm a huge fan of Red Garland. Some Benny Green, the great trombone player. Cool little copy of that one. Some Gil Melly, Primitive Modern. These are all from the mid-50s. Sorry, late 50s, but the mid 7000 sequence, Fountain Blue, Tad Dameron. I think this is actually recorded earlier. More Miles Davis with the Modern Jazz Giants. So we got some cool stuff coming for you guys. If you're in the area, come on out. If you're just watching from around the world, that's what you're missing. Some cool prestige today. Excited about everything. Appreciate all you guys' support all up to this point. Y'all have been amazing. I'm just got some fun stuff to dig into today. I'm going to try to come to the camera here once in a while and just share some stuff. Our sales were pretty strong yesterday for our first day. So that's encouraging. And again, I'll get back to you guys in a little bit here. So Peace Coffee, delicious stuff. It's what we're using here in the coffee shop. It was something that we had at our local gas station up in Minneapolis for years, and when I first started drinking black coffee back in 2017, it was a bit of an adjustment. I'm used to the cream and the sugar, and it took a nice, round, supple brew that had some buttery hints and just beautiful mouthful of, you know, body without being bitter or too much back-end bite. Just the perfect coffee, Peace Coffee Morning Glory blend. I'm sure it's available if you guys wanted to order some. Absolutely delicious stuff. One of the things I'm most excited about here is grafting jazz into people's lives. And I had some people already yesterday surprised by the ease with which they settled into a jazz setting. And there's just a lot of people who are kind of scared of jazz, and the jazz snobs have kind of driven them away and scared them off this music. And when they sit here and listen to something beautiful like Marilyn Moore doing her best Billie Holiday, some Barney Kessel. We played some great stuff yesterday. And, I mean, even people who had no idea the music or the context were really enjoying the atmosphere and the feeling. So I think it's one of the most important things I'm trying to present here is the accessibility of jazz to people and trying to graft it into their psyche as something that's perfect for a lot of settings. And a lot of people came in and said, man, I want to sit here and read a book, you know, which is what you want in a coffee shop. So I'm really excited about that challenge of getting jazz into the hearts and minds of people who aren't really accustomed to it, aren't really exposed to it. We are in rural America here. I'm 80 miles from the Twin Cities, 20 miles from Rochester, which is a big, globally renowned city for the Mayo Clinic. So there, our urban centers are a distance away. And to be out here in kind of rural America, exposing people to this music, it's something I'm very excited about. And it's a challenge because it's a language they aren't that comfortable with. Say hi. Wife just got back with some goodies. I'll check back with you guys a little bit later. Talk to you soon. Yeah, it's that's going to be one of the fun challenges, is just getting people who aren't really familiar with the language or have been exposed to it outside of film to have them learn to love and enjoy and make it feel like it's an accessible, interesting part of their day. And so that's going to be one of the things I really enjoy embarking on, is that challenge. I'll get back to you guys a little bit as our day unfolds. It's day number three today. We had a good day yesterday, very busy. It snowed, which is kind of intimate and romantic, and it kind of closes your setting in a little bit. Jazz on a snowy day in a coffee shop's not a bad place to be, honestly. I got a smile on my face. They've been long days, but I'm enjoying it. Today I want to talk to you about Gene Harris. And Gene Harris, who plays with the Three Sounds on Blue Note, and they make a great series of records on Blue Note. They're literally one of the great unheralded Blue Note artists. And Gene Harris is one of the great blues-influenced pianists of that era. And he continues to be a great pianist well into the 80s and 90s. I think in the early 2000s, my friend Jean-Michel, Reese Beethoven, knew Gene pretty well and is a big fan of a lot of his work. He sent me some of his later stuff on Concord. That's outstanding. There's a record that's only on CD he did. in the 90s or somewhere. Blue cover, jeans, blues, or something like that. I can't what it's called exactly. But there's a song there about Ahmad's Blues from Ahmad Jamal. And it's a very complicated piece that Jamal wrote. And he's just, the level of virtuosity is Art Tatum-like. But it's always rooted in a swing and a blues that's Basie-like. And he's such a great player with a lot of feel and a lot of gospel. And three sounds records are fun. They're affordable. You can get an old Blue Note and feel how that cover feels and how that vinyl feels in your hands, which is an outstanding, thrilling experience. And I'm listening to this record this morning in the coffee shop, and a couple things have jumped out at me right away. He's percussive, punctuated, delicate. I mean, there's a rhythm and a pulse to him, balanced with a real ability to be delicate and finite. You know, there's a finesse that's being exhibited all the time in his style. And again, there's a delicacy that's just fantastic. I find him enchanting. His whole run of records, whether it's Gene Harrison, The Three Sounds, or just The Three Sounds, he's got a real command of the keyboard. You know what I mean? He throws down with a velocity and an urgency and a feel and a swing that's unrivaled. He's one of the great piano players, and he's really unheralded. You know, it takes a deeper jazz fan to know how great Gene Harris is and was, and a lot of the snobbier jazz fans put on their monocle and look down upon The Three Sounds. Oh my God, I can't be any good. They only go for $40, $50 for original pressings. I must have $3,000 records only. If they don't go for that, they can't be any good. The pomposity of some of these people. And you know, you don't have to love Three Sounds, but I don't know why you wouldn't. I don't know what there's not to like. It's easy, it's fun, it's prancing. It's prancing about the room. Dickie Simpkins and Andrew Dowdy round up the rhythm section. And the three play together for quite a long time. If you look at the beautiful gloss of these old Blue Notes, bottoms up, The Three Sounds. Simpkins is a fine bass player. Got a lot of punch and a lot of juice. And of course, Bill Dowdy is a fantastic jazz drummer. I think he's from Detroit. Again, just one of the great groups of this time. And they probably make close to 20 records at Blue Note and then do a few things at like Mercury, and then Gene Harris ends up at Concord. He works with Ray Brown a lot. And Ray Brown and Gene Harris together is a great deal of blues-based virtuosity. It's never complicated or confused or conflicted with the ego of virtuosity. It's blues-based. It's full of freedom and swing. It's never self-aware. It's never like, what are people thinking? Am I playing the right thing? It's just the pocket. I mean, that space in your head that fits in your soul. When mind and soul connect, a magic energy can be propulsed upon your surrounding cosmos. And energy is the essence of light, and energy and matter and all of this being. And boy, jazz can just emanate that. Jazz can just punctuate the dark and add life and joy to your day. And so it's jazz like this, I feel, is essential to rebirthing a love in jazz in the average common person. And so it's why in the cafe, you're going to hear stuff like this. Had some great Peggy Lee on yesterday that I enjoyed extremely. And I will be honest, it's a record I used to listen to a lot, and I had totally forgotten or hadn't looked in so long. I mean, I've listened to this record a lot over the years, but maybe I hadn't looked at the cover and really read the information on it in so long that I didn't recognize Quincy Jones back 15 years ago when I bought, I probably bought this back in number 2588 in my collection, so this probably goes back to the late 90s when I bought this. I might not have really known who Quincy Jones was then, at least not to the degree I do today, But Quincy Jones is doing the arrangements on this, and this is a fun record. And you really get the feel for what Miss Peggy Lee is capable of. She can shout the blues, she can sing a pop song, she's dynamic, she's fun, she's flirtatious. And she's a North Dakota native, which also gives her a unique iron to forge. There's not a lot of North Dakotans in the world of jazz or even in the world of entertainment. I also listened to a really great Julie London record. It's here somewhere, all right here. And again, I've said this before, vocal jazz records are so hinging upon who is arranging the music. And from Sinatra to Julie London to Peggy Lee to Billie Holiday, who is making your backing track will impact greatly how that music sounds and how you come across. Teddy King, when she's with a small jazz trio, she's marvelous. When she's in a more rigid Columbia Capitol Studios with the big orchestras and the big conductors and the absolute micromanaging of all the inflection and sound, it boxes singers in, honestly. A singer is free in a jazz trio. There's not a whole lot of anyone saying you need or must or conform to this, which gives it just a freedom and a boy, when you get a great singer with a great jazz trio, that's a great record. And so you hear Julie London, she's playing with Jimmy Rowles. And Jimmy Rowles is a great West Coast guy. His In a Weather Vane record's fantastic on that, I can't think of the name of the label, a cool little label that's on. He played with Billie Holiday and backed her sometimes. You gotta love that type of record. That Julie London record's fantastic. That Peggy Lee record's fantastic. But the three sounds, they punctuate life. They express the joy in life. And I swear by the great Gene Harris and the three sounds. I promise you that. Have a great day. We'll talk to you soon. Peace.